Hey everybody, this is PJ Riley from Lancaster Archery here in our video studio today. We're here with pro archer Dan McCarthy. He's representing Black Eagle today. And Dan, you had a killer season this year, especially on the ASA, Shooter of the Year Open Pro. And one of the reasons is this in-time system that we're going to talk about, which is super technical. I mean, it's super simple product,
yeah.
But technical in what it does, and the range of what it can do is incredible. So give us a rundown of what it is, and then we'll dive into how you apply it.
Okay, so basically what I tried to make was a timing system in order to incrementally adjust your timing inside of what you're able to do with cables. So essentially, you know, when one cam would hit and then the other cam would just barely be off the wall, right, or maybe a little bit off, and then you would put that half a twist in to try to time those, and mm-hmm. it would flip-flop them. It would make it so this cam would hit and now this cam would be off.
Right.
And so you just had to kind of choose, well, is it better for my top cam to hit first, or is it better for my bottom cam to hit first? And you had to make that decision.
Really. You only have half twists.
Yes.
So that's all you can
yeah.
do.
Yep. And so I just wanted something that was a very repeatable method of being able to, you know, incrementally bring those in together to where they're actually timed together. And so the simplest way I could do that, and I worked this through for different sizes and stuff as well, but we developed these basic spacers. They're in-time cam timing spacers, and they're a series of basic hourglass shapes, okay? Mm-hmm. And so they're gonna hold their position in the cables. You don't have to tie them in or anything. But you're basically just changing the path of the string, which is what twisting and untwisting does. So when you put a half a twist in, you're essentially shortening that cable length, okay? And what these are doing is changing, you know, from a straight path of a string, you're basically making the string go out and around one of these spacers, which just incrementally shortens that cable
yep.
length.
Mm-hmm.
And so by changing the size of that spacer, you can shorten it a lot, or you can shorten it a little, or you can use one, or you can use a series of different combinations or a different size. So that's essentially the idea.
So each kit, Dan, comes with 8 of these hourglasses. They're different sizes, 2 of the same size, 4 different sizes.
Yes.
So that combination gives you a total range of 14 different steps you could go through, different combinations
yes.
of these hourglasses
yep.
to affect things differently. And as you were telling me that I found surprising, even if your cam, you know, you put this into a draw board and you see that your cams are perfectly timed, you still like to have them in there. Why?
Because you always have the option to remove them. And sometimes, you know, if you don't carry this with you all the time, you still have the option of if temperature changes stuff and you check your timing and it's out, if you have two, you know, of the smallest ones in there, you're able to pull one of those and then make an adjustment from there. You're also able to incrementally step up on the other cable if you wanted to add another one to the other side. So it just gives you the option of, you know, just making those super fine adjustments. And we'll talk about some of that stuff as we make these adjustments.
And the adjustment, so let's talk about my bow here. So we have this one in here, and we basically, it started out, the bottom cam was touching first and the top cam was not touching.
Yes.
And you demonstrated, you put a half twist in that bottom cable and it took my top cam to touching and now my bottom cam was off.
Yeah.
So that's where we're at now. Top cam touching, bottom one not. And we're going to fix that with the in-time system.
Yes. And so I've done quite a few of these, but we'll step through exactly kind of how I would recommend you doing it. Until you find out how your individual bow reacts to each size, just start with the smallest spacer and work your way up. So essentially, you know, where we're at with this, again, we're gonna time it from the top cam at full draw, touching the stop, touching the cable, bottom cam's off just a little bit. And so in that scenario, what I'd recommend doing is starting with counting your strands. You know, in this particular bow, we have a, you know, one solid string. If you have a multicolored string, it's easier to split if it's a dual strand. But just, you know, this is a 22 strand string. Mm-hmm. So if you could just take a little pressure off. This is where, like, another tip I would recommend for somebody like this that has a solid colored string. All I do on mine, if I have solid, I like to use natural a lot for color. I just tie a piece of serving around the bundle. So that way, every time I want to, you know, stick one in or pull one out of here, I don't have to recount my strands. Yeah. So if I drop a spacer or something and I have to let go or anything, it just allows me to, you know, find that split very easily. Okay. So that's 11 strands. And so all we're going to do is basically insert. And like I said, this top cam's touching. We're trying to catch the other cam up to the top cam so they're even. And in that instance, we would twist. We would pop this off and put a half a twist would be the next step to try to bring those into time. Again, if we did that, it would flip-flop it. Because like we talked about, it was the opposite. We did the half a twist. So that's why I'm working with this particular cable.
In twisting, the way they do it is the cam that touches first, that would be the one you twist. So we're not twisting. Instead, it's the cable.
We're working on that same cable, but we're shortening it incrementally just by installing one of these in here.
Okay.
And the only time you really have to worry, you don't have to tie these in, but just be conscious of it, that they're not tied in. If you do take pressure off with a bow press, there's a possibility of them,
that
you know, potentially falling out.
So shooting, just, you shot these things all year?
I've never
had one come out.
Never.
So, all right, Dan, so we went to the draw board, put it in there, what'd we see?
All right, so basically I started with a B. So like the second, let's just call it a number two. You know, the number one or number two.
Second
or B.
Smallest.
Yep, the second small size. I knew that that'd probably get us really close. And it's not quite perfect. It's super close. It's considerably closer than where it was.
Yeah.
When we started, we put a half twist.
Right.
But now we have the bottom touching and the top is just barely off. It's probably maybe 12 thousandths or 10 thousandths off.
And let's talk about, why is this important? What if I just left that like that? What would the result be? Well, for you, not for me.
Well, so basically a lot of timing, the biggest difference, you're gonna feel most of it. So when the cams are both timed evenly, they're generally like less aggressive on the back wall. So both cams are gonna wanna be letting off evenly. The wall is gonna feel more stable, more solid.
Mm-hmm.
It's gonna change the feel of the back of the wall. And then on top of that, it's gonna change the function of how those cams rotate. So it's gonna change your tune.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the other thing it's gonna do is possibly change your knock travel a little bit. And so if your top cam's off the wall, a lot of times that's gonna show through paper as a high tear. And as you dial this in, as you bring that top cam into time with that bottom cam, you're also gonna bring your tear down a little bit. So it's gonna give you a bullet hole. It's just gonna change the way both cams work together in time, in sync. And you know, it allows you also to adjust and custom adjust that the back end of what works the best for you. So some people, you've probably heard people talk about it as, you know, I like my top cam to hit just barely ahead of my bottom. Or I like my bottom to hit first. And so this allows you to not necessarily shoot the cams perfectly in, you know, sync with each other, but allows you to adjust the timing of those cams in an orientation that you prefer or that is the most forgiving for you.
We're going for perfect here just to do that, but if you discover as an archer that something else works better, this allows you to do that on that micro level, as we're saying, not just by half twists.
Yes, this allows you to really dial it into exactly what works perfect for you.
So what we're gonna do for our fix is we're just gonna go to the smallest hourglass into the same cable. We're just gonna change sizes.
Yeah, so basically when we started with the bow, our original timing of the bow, top cam was hitting first, bottom cam was just a little bit behind. That was as close as we could get it with twisting the string.
Yep.
And so now we're actually tested and tried a guess, basically, number two spacer, you know, the medium spacer. And like you said, it flip-flopped. So now our top's just barely off, our bottom's touching. And so we know we used too large of a spacer. Now we want to shrink down and go just a little bit smaller.
And we want to make sure people don't get confused by that. This is simple. This is all you're doing is working through these steps to try the different sizes to get the timing to come around.
Yep.
It's not confusing at all.
No, and you don't necessarily, you just need to know which cable to work on, which cable you need to shorten or which cable you need to lengthen in order to time bows. And if you know that, once you get to the point where, you know, which cable do I need to shorten, we know that it's this cam because that's where, you know, what was hitting first. So I just took a shot at the number two.
Exactly.
And we wanted to show you guys, you know, nope, that still wasn't enough, or it was too much, and now we need to dial into the to try to get the right one. And again, every cam on every bow model that's out there, it's gonna move them differently. That amount of space is gonna rotate, you know, one cam different than the other. So you know, there's no diagram of exactly it's going to move it this far for this size.
And we were talking earlier too, this has nothing to do with the strings in terms of quality. It doesn't
absolutely
matter
not
what string is in there, or that, you know, it's a problem because you have to do this, you know, to this string. Doesn't matter. That's
irrelevant.
No,
this is just one of those things that actually makes a set of strings awesome, because a really high quality set of strings, you're only looking for stability. You're looking for a string that's going to be very stable, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's to the exact length that it needs to be.
Exactly.
And you're going to have some variance there. Even if you build your strings to thousandths of an inch the same, the way those cams rotate and the way these limbs deflect and the way everything pulls on a cable guard doesn't necessarily mean that both your cams are going to hit stops the same. So really all you're doing with this stuff is this gives you the opportunity, even if everything's, you know, theoretically perfect, it's still probably not going to hit exactly the same. So you can dial this in as close as you want, or as close as you can get it. And it just really gives you that much more, you know, function.
Gotcha. All right, so we've put in the smallest one, and we're going to see how that affected our timing.
We're putting it in right now. Good.
All right, Dan, so we made our swap there. We went to the smallest hourglass in the top cable.
Yep.
And now we got the timing correct.
Yes, so now both cams are in time.
Both cams are in time. Now, I got a couple questions. First question is, does it matter where I put these?
As far as in the cable?
Yes. We have it down in this position. Would it matter if it was up here?
No, it really wouldn't. And really, I put mine down here in the lower part of my cable because it's just out of the way. There's not a string stop in the way or anything like that. You could also put them up here. But really, I just do all of my adjustments down there on one side. That's where I have a little, you know, holder where I can set stuff. So it really doesn't matter. I mean, obviously you can't stick them in serving. So close to the serving is a good spot. And if you're gonna put two of them in there, I wanna show like how to stack multiple into a cable, how I'd recommend it. You don't want them too close together. You want an actual string twist in between. You don't want the two spacers sharing the same split in the string.
Which that is right now.
Yeah, so this is what would be incorrect. This would be like, it's easy to install it close to the other stop because there's already, you know, that's where the strands are split.
Right.
So go ahead and stick it in there, but then just slide it up your cable and then let go and let the string twist. I mean, as long as there's one twist in it, you're good. If there's two twists, that's fine, doesn't matter. Just make sure that there's like a twist around or in between. Yep, each one. And that's gonna make sure that the string goes out and around both spacers, holds them good and in place. And that's really it. I mean, that's all you have to worry about.
So Dan, these things, do they affect speed?
So
speedier though?
By themselves, no. Will your speed possibly change? It could. It could speed up or it could slow down. Because again, you're actually adjusting your cam synchronization. So you're making your cams efficiently, you know, function together. So if you're, you know, you might see an increase in speed, but if you pull one out, essentially you're lengthening your cable. So you're incrementally actually taking some pressure off of your limbs. So you could actually remove one and slow your bow down. And we're talking about like tenths of a foot,
you know,
minimal. But if you're shooting for redding or something like that, you're going to see a bigger adjustment in your impact just from it changing your knock height than you are going to see in actual speed as far as how it affects the overall function of the entire mechanical system.
I was going to say, one of the things we know is that once you, you know, if you are using the cables and you're twisting to adjust cam time, we know putting twists into the cables increases your speed.
Yes, because it's going to increase poundage, it's going to increase draw length. And these are basically doing the same thing, but on an incremental level. So by themselves, the weight of that thing is not going to change your speed. But how it adjusts the mechanical system, you can see an increase or a decrease in speed depending on whether you're installing them or removing them or how your cams function together.
Gotcha. All right, Dan, so we have this thing perfectly timed now with the hourglass in there. Everything works, as you mentioned, perfectly synced. That's where we want to start, and then we can figure out from there if that's the best.
Yeah, if that fits your style or how you want that back wall to feel or, you know, your impacts or whatever, your gauge off.
So I'm looking, and the ones that we use today are blue, but I see orange. I mean, there are several colors. I know there's green. There's several colors. Hey, archers, we like to jazz up our bows.
Yeah, you guys like your colors. So yeah, we have a lot of popular colors that'll match, you know, strings, sights, rests. Just giving people some options as far as to see what people like.
Absolutely. All right, that is the in-time cam timing system for Black Eagle. Great, very simple product, but yet a lot that it can do. That's definitely awesome. If you like this video, give us a thumbs up. If you want to see more videos like it, subscribe to our YouTube channel. Don't forget to click that bell to get notifications whenever we put out new videos. And as always, if you have any questions, you can visit us at lancasterarchery.com.